The American War between the States is one of the most famous historical events in American history, and it is filled with devout Christians, whether Catholic or Protestant, who fought and died for their respective causes during the war. Usually historians and history buffs focus on Christian military figures of the war that are some of the most famous Confederate men of that period, such as General Robert E. Lee, General Thomas Stonewall Jackson, both from Virginia, or lesser-known figures like Private Samuel Sam Davis of the 1st Tennessee Regiment. But one does not have to leave their state to find devout Christian men of the Confederate States of America who left their homes to fight on the battlefield against an invading force from the north. In fact, one does not have to even travel outside of their own county, which is the case for myself, who lives in the county of Alamance in the state of North Carolina, well known as the Tar Heel State. One such Christian, Confederate soldier of Alamance County, North Carolina, was Lynn Banks Holt, or Banks, as his family affectionately called him. According to Dr. William Vincent and the Alamance County Historical Museum, Lynn Banks Holt was born in 1842 to Edwin Michael Holt and Emily Farish Holt, and was raised on Oak Grove Plantation, a 1,693-acre farm, which was near the town of Alamance, North Carolina, and had, over the course of its years, 151 slaves, but by 1861, only around 48 slaves worked on the plantation. Dr. Vincent further states that when Banks was a boy growing up in the 1850s, his home plantation, under his father's guidance, quote, produced about 2,000 bushels of corn, 1,200 bushels of oats annually, in addition to substantial quantities of fruits, vegetables, dairy products, beef, and pork, close quote. With the addition that their plantation made, quote, some 15,000 pounds of salted pork each year, close quote. And during the year 1860, the plantation mill put out, quote, 5,000 bushels of meal and 670 barrels of flour, close quote. Not to mention that the plantation had its own, quote, whiskey distillery, vineyard, sawmill, brickyard, and a tannery, close quote. Dr. Vincent further states that Banks was raised a devout Lutheran Christian by his father and mother and attended St. Paul's Lutheran Church, just down the road from the plantation, when services were available. For, as Dr. Vincent asserts, during Banks' boyhood and young adulthood in the 1840s and 1850s, there was not a permanent pastor but circuit-riding ministers during this time. Banks' father described in his diary of going to different churches to hear Sunday morning services, and even the attendance of camp revival meetings at Hoffield's Presbyterian Church and Crossroads Presbyterian Church. Although Edwin Holt did not say that Banks, quote, got religion, close quote, or even being there like his other children, there could not be any doubt that Banks was with them and, according to Dr. Vincent, shared in a faith in Christ. Though born a plantation son, Dr. Vincent went on to say that Banks entered the Hillsboro Military Academy to receive his, quote, secondary education, close quote, which was in the county of Orange, right next to Alamance. Banks' father recorded in his diary that Banks left for the academy in July of 1857, making Banks 15 years old when he left home for the academy. Banks would not find himself finishing his studies at Hillsboro Academy, for Dr. Vincent asserts that Banks left Hillsboro to join the Confederate cause after North Carolina seceded from the Union in May of 1861 to join the Confederate States of America. On July 2nd or the 3rd of 1861, according to Edwin Holt's diary and the North Carolina Regimental roster, Banks enlisted in Company F of the 6th North Carolina State Troops, quote, for the war, close quote, when he was 20 years old. According to the North Carolina roster and Durward T. Stokes, the 6th North Carolina received orders on July 8th to travel from the town of Company Shops, present-day Burlington, North Carolina, to Raleigh, and then head out to Virginia to become part of the Confederate Army there, since it was under threat of invasion by Union forces. And it was in this company and regiment Banks participated in the first official battle of the American War between the States that began the four-year-long bloodshed. Also, almost 4 years of bloodshed for this young man from Alamance County, North Carolina. According to historian Stephen Woodworth, on July 21, 1861, near Manassas Junction, Virginia, Confederate forces under the commands of Generals Joseph E. Johnston and P.G.T. Beauregard were attacked by Union forces commanded by General Irvin McDowell, who was attempting to make his way to the Confederate capital of Richmond. Banks and the 6th North Carolina were in the midst of the fighting, and according to the North Carolina roster, the regiment advanced on their own across the battlefield and made their way to Henry House Hill and rendezvoused with the rest of their Confederate comrades to push back the Federals from the hill. This action helped the Confederates win the day over the Federal forces at the Battle of First Manassas. Although in the dead center of the fighting, Banks did not receive a single wound. His father, Edwin, recorded in his diary the following. Sunday, July 21st, 1861. Great battle at Manassas. General Fisher killed. Great victory won by the Confederate Army. Terrible slaughter. Alexander and Banks in the battle. Both escape unhurt. Edwin M. Holt. According to Dr. Vincent, Banks would go on to serve with the 6th North Carolina when the Confederates took Fort Macon from federal hands, which earned him a promotion from the rank and file to an officer and a transfer to the 8th North Carolina Regiment in October of 1861. Because of this transfer, Banks went to Raleigh, and there he reunited with his father, Edwin. And by the indication of Edwin's diary, Banks traveled to Oak Grove with his father while suffering with some illness and stayed with his family until he reported for duty with his new regiment at Roanoke in December of 1861. According to the North Carolina roster, Banks served with the 8th North Carolina at the Battle of Roanoke in February of 1862 and was captured after Union forces succeeded in taking the island. He eventually went back with the 8th after a prisoner exchange during the month of August of 1862. And from late August to early September of 1863, he participated in the Second Battle of Charleston. In May of 1864, Banks with the 8th North Carolina partook in a military expedition in eastern North Carolina. According to H.T.J. Ludwig, another soldier in the 8th North Carolina, their task was to journey to the city of New Bern and there assault Union troops surrounding the city. Banks recorded in his 1864 diary that their journey from Plymouth to New Bern, but they did not stay there long to do their task. Where Ludwig related that the 8th received orders to travel to Virginia and join the Army of Northern Virginia to reinforce it at Petersburg, Virginia. Retracing their steps, Banks recorded their journey from New Bern to Weldon, North Carolina, and then to Petersburg, where they arrived on May 11, 1864. But again, like New Bern, Banks and the 8th North Carolina did not stay there for long. According to historian Stephen Woodworth, a Union army under General Benjamin Butler was making its way from the James River section of Virginia in order to cut off Lee's army from any contact from the south. And in response, Lee sent a contingent of his force under the command of General P.G.T. Beauregard to stop Butler. After a couple of engagements with each other, the two armies fought the climactic battle during this campaign at Proctor's Creek from May 12th through the 16th, 1864. Banks recorded the following about the battle in his diary. May 12th, 1864. Left Petersburg with a force 9,000 strong, General Hoke in command, camped in line of battle 6 miles from Petersburg, all quiet in front. May 13th, 1864. Moved off at 4 o'clock a.m., arrived at the outer works of Drury's Bluff. 10 a.m., the enemy came out into the turnpike just after we had part-formed their lines around our works and attacked General Ransom's brigade on the right and were repulsed. General Ransom and two of his staff were wounded. May 14th, 1864, abandoned our outer works and moved back to a strong position near Drury's Bluff. The enemy advanced on us immediately, and some skirmish took place. Captain Rogers was badly wounded. May 16th, 1864. The battle commenced early in the morning and raged some 5 hours with great success to our arms and resulted in the driving back the enemy at every point in the direction of his gunboats with a loss of 2,500 prisoners. Our casualties are numerous. Banks Holt. After this Confederate victory, the final significant engagement between Butler and Beauregard took place at the Battle of Ware Bottom Church on May 20, 1864, and again it was a victory for Beauregard's army. Banks wrote the following about the battle. May 20, 1864. Early in the morning, six brigades of our army attacked the enemy, and after a hot and bloody conflict, drove them from their line of rifle pits and into their main line of works. Banks Holt. According to historian Stephen Woodworth, after this last significant engagement, Beauregard's troops constructed lines of trenches to block any moves Butler would make in the future. However, Banks recorded on May 31st that he and many of his fellow Confederates in Beauregard's force departed to join the main part of the Confederate army at Petersburg. Banks would not stay there for long either, for according to the roster, he fought with the 8th North Carolina at the Battle of Chaffin's Farm in Newmarket Heights on September 30th, 1864, where he was wounded and was taken prisoner once again by Union forces, and there he would stay. For Banks, the war was over. Even though he was in Union hands as a prisoner of war, Banks still recorded very short entries in his diary the places where he was detained. He wrote that he first went to Fort Monroe in Virginia on October 8, 1864, and then was transferred on December 23rd to Point Lookout in Maryland, arriving there on December 24th. After leaving there on January 2nd, 1865, Banks recorded that he traveled to and arrived at Old Capitol Prison in Washington, D.C., on January 3rd. A month later, he was taken to Fort Delaware, which was in the border state of Delaware. It was there he stayed, according to the roster, until 2 months after the war ended, when he swore to be loyal to the United States on the 17th of June, 1865, and was allowed to finally go home after almost four bloody years of fighting for his home state. There is no known record of when Banks came home or the reception he received upon his arrival back at Oak Grove, even though there can be no doubt it was a warm one from his family and friends. According to Dr. Vincent, Banks eventually married Mary Catherine Bebbin in October of 1865 and went into the milling industry with his father, who owned several mills in Alamance County already. Although there is no known written record of Banks mentioning his faith, Dr. Vincent argues that there is no evidence to suggest that Banks did not remain a devout Lutheran throughout his young life and during the war and into the 1870s, until he switched Protestant denominations in 1885 and became a devout Presbyterian. He was so devout that his obituary in the Alamance Gleaner in October 28, 1920, the year in which he died, the following was said of him, quote, "He was a member of Grand Presbyterian Church, and for many years, a ruling elder in his church." Close quote. A devout Christian and loyal Confederate till the end, Lynn Banks Holt deserves our remembrance for his story to be continually told in the coming years of time until our Lord Jesus Christ returns again. Thank you for watching, and God bless you.